I'm Chris White, and this is the Electric Jesus Podcast. Let me set the scene for you. Coming off an incredible performance at the Ichthus Music Festival, 316 has a motel room meeting with Christian rock star Chris Angelopoulos. Chris tells them they have a chance to open for Stryper and Motley Crue in Los Angeles, but they'll need to audition at a secular rock club first. See how they do in front of a non-Christian audience.
The Purgatorio, I mean, if you want to, I mean, this is a real rock and roll club, all right?
I don't know. I'm not sure I want this band playing a venue where they serve alcohol.
Hey, Skip. I kind of agree with Michael.
Ah, there it is. Should a Christian band play in a place that serves alcohol? The usually quiet sound man, Eric, stands. He has something to say.
Chris is right. This band's the real deal. And this opportunity to play 316 songs in a real rock club filled with lost people. Guys, this is what it's all about. Look, I don't know about you, but I'm tired of preaching to the choir at these churches and camps. I mean, half of these people, they think all rock is evil. They don't want to hear our music. We should play somewhere where they do.
The kid has a point.
I want to make Jesus famous.
Amen.
So I say we rock the hell out of this
Purgatorio.
Purgatorio.
And the band says yes. Welcome to season two of the Electric Jesus Podcast. I'm your host, Chris White, writer, director, and producer of the 2021 rock and roll comedy, Electric Jesus. Last season, we went behind the scenes to discover the music that inspired the world of Electric Jesus and the amazing work our team did to create an all-new soundtrack for the film. Well, this season, I've selected nine key scenes from the film to talk about with fellow artists, authors, academics, pastors, old friends, and new. There will be spoilers, so if you've not yet seen the film, I encourage you to watch it. It's streaming all over the place. Just Google it. Or better, click the link to our streaming partners in the show notes. And if you have seen the film, well, I'm guessing that since you're listening to this, the film connected with you. I'm glad, and I hope these conversations add to your enjoyment and appreciation of Electric Jesus.
Episode 6, The Hero Moment.
Chris Hansen is an independent filmmaker. He is the chair of the Department of Film and Digital Media at Baylor University in Waco, Texas. Chris has made 5 feature films. The most recent is 7 short films about our marriage, which I think is an anthology feature, but maybe it's not.
Well, it's 7 segments about one marriage. So it's actually 7. It's a single story about one marriage. So it's just divided into 7 pieces. Right. So I don't think of it as an anthology.
Well, the film is excellent. It premiered at Cinequest in San Jose. It's available Amazon, sir. iTunes, everywhere you stream movies. Go grab it. Check it out. You'll see Chris's latest work. Chris and I are friends, I think, because we have the same first name.
And and also because we have very similar tastes. The things that I dream up and want to do are very similar in a lot of ways to things he dreams up and wants to do. But thanks for talking to me about Electric Jesus today, Chris.
Oh, yeah.
Is this correct? You grew up in evangelical youth groups culture.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, for sure.
In the 80s, 90s? When?
Yeah,
okay.
80s, yeah. Yeah, we're close to the same age, aren't we?
I'm 52.
Yeah, I'm 51. I'll be 52 in July.
I like asking people that grew up in that world like me, what were the things about that time that drew you to film, that drew you into a creative profession, into creative storytelling? Were there things?
So I grew up in the South. I grew up in the Atlanta area.
Okay.
But my parents and I are originally from New York. So my parents grew up in Brooklyn, and then I was born in Staten Island, New York. And we left Staten Island when I was like, I think about 8 years old. And that was about the time, it was not long before that, when we converted from Catholicism to evangelical Christianity.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So my parents grew up very much kind of immersed in pop culture, you know, movie lovers and music lovers, and becoming Christians didn't immediately change that. Now, we did become the kind of Christians that were like, you know, afraid of rock music. And
oh, you did. Oh,
yeah. No, totally. All the things that Electric Jesus, you know, explores, and, you know, fear of, you know, the devil in rock music and those kinds of things. But my mother also loved disco, and, you know, my father loved the Beatles. And among the things that my parents loved were movies. My dad took my brother and I to see movies all the time. I mean, it moderated a little bit because there were certain movies that, you know, we didn't go see because, I mean, there was always the rating thing when we were kids, but there were certain movies about certain kinds of subjects that we didn't go see. But beyond that, it was just like, well, we loved movies. And so we grew up loving movies. And my dad showed us the Universal horror movies and the, you know, we loved Werewolf and Frankenstein and Dracula and Abbott and Costello. And, you know, we grew up loving that stuff. So I was always attracted to the movies.
I had a similar experience growing up. My parents loved to go to movies, my dad especially. And I can remember leaving movies, walking out of the theater to the car, and my dad kind of connecting something we saw to the Bible in some way.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And which was cool because it helped me start seeing the layers that are going on in a film, whether it was intended or not. I don't know if his criticism of the movies was correct or not. But, you know, you see The Empire Strikes Back, and then there's some biblical allusion he saw in it.
Yeah.
So I was getting my movies that me and my friends would see, but a little bit of,
here's your biblical object lesson.
Yeah. This is not removed from our faith. What about at church? Did you have opportunities to express yourself creatively in the context of youth group or?
Our youth pastor, when I was young, was very creative and fun and funny. And my brother and I loved to do skits and sketches and that kind of thing. And the youth pastor, he was a ham and he loved to do that kind of stuff too. And so, I mean, I remember a weekend where we had a video camera. We spent the whole weekend with us and one of our best friends and the youth pastors making stupid, funny, Saturday Night Live style sketches with him. And we had a blast. We loved doing that kind of stuff. And he loved it too. I mean, and he was irreverent, for a reverend. We had a blast with him, and he was a God loving guy, but he also had a good, fun sense of humor and loved to make fun of things. And I think he rubbed off on us too. And so, you know, I look back and there was a lot of, there's a lot of negative stuff that we learned in evangelical Christianity, but there was also a lot of good stuff that we got in terms of friendships and even among the pastor, the youth pastor and the youth group, there were a lot of good people and good friends that came out of it.
People find this strange, and you won't, because this was similar to your experience, but people find it strange when I tell them that I first exercised these creative muscles, you know, in the context of church, whether it was acting or writing or all sorts of performance, all sorts of video production, like you're talking about. I knew that I wanted to be a creative person.
Yeah.
And I knew it was more than just goofing off with friends, but it really was nurtured there. When did it occur to you that you could do those things outside of church and still be a Christian? In other words, you wouldn't have to renounce your faith to make a Hollywood movie.
I was always doing it. I mean, my dad brought, like, I remember he brought a video camera home from work. It was a black and white VHS video camera.
Oh, neat.
The two things we made were essentially a remake of Rocky, which I loved back when I was a kid. Yeah. I mean, I still have great affection for Rocky.
Yeah, it's a great movie.
So we remade Rocky, and we also made like an original detective story that my brother wrote. We just loved making stuff, you know, all the time. So that's kind of segued into like my college years and my high school and college years, where I wanted to be a writer, but I wasn't really thinking at that point about film or television. I was just thinking about like writing novels and writing poetry. I remember actually I went on a semester long trip to Europe when I was in college. And at that point I was thinking, I was very into poetry. I was an English major and I was writing poetry and short stories and things like that, you know, trying to be a, you know, intellectual. And I remember speaking to one of the professors who was, he was a pastor, but he was British. So he was one of the professors who was kind of hosting us over there. He was a pastor and he was teaching us British history, but he was just a wonderful guy who was spending a lot of time with us, kind of mentoring us. And I was kind of bemoaning the fact that as a Christian, I was like, well, how can I be a poet, I'm a Christian, and I'm like, and he was like, yeah, there's no poetry in the Bible. And I was like, oh yeah, that's a good point, Mark, thanks. And he really opened my eyes to the fact that, you know, there is, like, the Bible was full of great writing, not just, you know, biblical truth, but great writing. It kind of merged those two things together for me. And then I realized, well, I can be a writer who writes things that are full of, you know, the reality of who I am. And they don't have to be, you know, I don't have to be writing the Bible. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. So, I come across, I'm sure you do, because of your work at the university, which, for the record, Baylor is not a Bible college, but it has some faith element to it, I guess, to the culture, and began as a Baptist thing, right? Baylor was founded by Baptists.
Yeah, its heritage is Baptist. It's definitely, they consider themselves a Christian university, but it's not a Christian university in the sense that you might say Liberty or, you know, Regent University or
right,
or Lee, even where I went, Lee University is that.
Well, in that kind of environment, I think you probably encounter students that come to school with some faith background and that impulse to create. And I find a lot of people now, I don't remember this as strongly when we were younger, but it seems like a lot of people now just kind of, I guess there's reasons for this, but the sense of, okay, I do want to be creative. I do want to make movies or make music or make art, but I'm going to be a Christian version of that,
yes,
which means that my films have some kind of story of faith, or my music sings about Jesus or something.
Well, I've encountered that my whole life, because I went to predominantly Christian schools. I went to, you know, Lee University, which was Lee College back when I went. Everybody who did want to create anything there probably thought like that. Or do you remember Michael Medved?
Yeah.
In his Hollywood versus America book that came out when I was in college, and he went on speaking tour and he came to Lee.
It's still a thing. It's still a thing.
Oh yeah. People, for sure.
Still, yeah.
Mm-hmm. For sure. And I remember him speaking and we were all like, "Ooh, Michael Medved's coming to Lee," you know? And I remember going and listening to him speak. And I remember this girl raising her hand to ask a question, and she said, she prefaced her question by saying, "Well, I think movies are of the devil."
I've definitely seen a few that were of the devil.
Oh, sure, sure. Sometimes they think for completely different reasons than she thinks. Yes. And I'm just like, you know, a medium is probably not of the devil, but anything can be used of the devil. And I think we've seen in 2023 that Christianity can be used by the devil. But that's, you know,
yeah.
As Baylor has grown to have a national and international reputation. Yeah. People know it for something other than its Christian heritage. So people come here and they may have a Christian background or they may not. It's been interesting to watch people who just want to create in our program and don't necessarily have that background. For example, my directing. So, you know, everybody who is hired to teach here is a Christian though.
Okay.
And does have to kind of pass that, you know, that acid test. And so we all bring that to the classroom to some degree or another.
I bring it up because it is something that always, it was a tension with me as a young man, you know, how far I could tiptoe into quote unquote the world and still be a Christian. Like, can I go? I remember in high school going to see a band play at a rock club downtown. It was one of these things where everybody at school was talking about, we're going to go see this band. And then I'm the only one that showed up, you know, and it was at a bar. And I remember getting orange juice to drink at the bar as I stood on the front row. I felt like I needed to have a drink because everybody had a drink, but I was, what, 17 or something. I think that scene, the scene in the movie that we're talking about, the scene of in the hero's journey idea, it's accepting the call moment. That this is really a dilemma for the kids in this rock band, which the lead singer is kind of the leader of the band, literally says, like, I don't think we should play somewhere where they serve alcohol, meaning we're Christians. I don't think it'd be wise for us to go into this place, which is the essence of why the promoter wants them to go to that place. They
right.
say, can you survive, you know, the belly of the beast, I think the guy calls it. But it really went into that. That's where the scene came from, was my own. Remember, I wasn't in a band, but I remember moments like that. And these two competing ideas, this idea of, as Christians, we are set apart and we kind of have a lifestyle and an approach to living that is here and that is not of the world.
Yeah.
There was also messaging like, we need to go to the world to tell them about Jesus. That tension felt very present to me. Did it feel that way to you when you were younger?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, I think that scene brings back so many memories of that argument between preaching to the choir versus.
Yeah.
I mean, it's funny because it feels like a very obvious scene in some ways, but that's because for you and me, it's very obvious. Mm-hmm. For you and me, it's like, well, duh, you know, but it's but for the audience that's not as familiar with evangelicalism, didn't grow up and steeped in it, it's not as obvious.
It gets a laugh.
Right.
If I've seen it with an audience when he says, I don't alcohol.
Yeah.
People laugh. And then the other kid says, yeah, I'm kind of with him. And people are like, what? You know, there's like an incredulousness.
When he makes the argument that, you know, these are the people that need to hear this. We need to bring Jesus to them and sing to them and not just preach to the choir. I'm like, It's almost like, well, yeah, duh, you know,
right.
It's just so full. It's so full of truth, not just the truth of what he's saying, but the truth of the moment, because it's very real. I mean, it brings me right back to stuff that I would have heard or said, you know, back in those days.
And then you even have Eric, our main character, who's kind of a quiet kid the whole movie and doesn't really assert much of him. And it's his moment of just like, I'm going to say something important now.
Yes. Yeah.
Again, for that kind of Christian kid, that kind of, a little shy, maybe on the fringes, maybe not used to saying big prophetic things, especially the sound man who doesn't really have a voice in a band. Did you ever hear a speech like that growing up? Did you ever give a speech like that? Like, come on, guys.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, for sure. I don't know if I ever gave one. I wasn't that brave as a kid growing up. But, you know, the come on, guys moment, I think, is in a youth group kind of setting, I think it's bound to happen. I think that's what really rang true about it, is that there's that, gosh, I think it just feels real in that there's this, you know, stirring up the courage to kind of do the right thing, but there's competing notions of what's the right thing, because, you know, the guys who are saying, you know, let's not go into the, you know, the devil's den, and you know, they do have a notion of this, of what the right thing is for them. Mm-hmm. It's not because they're resisting the call for a reason. There's not, there is a belief that they're doing the right thing, but then, you know, his explanation of why that is the right thing for them to go is just a better explanation. And I love it because they're kids. And so there's that kind of misunderstanding of why, you know, just not going to a place that has alcohol is somehow the good thing. And it is that kind of twisted take on reality that evangelicalism sometimes leads you to, is like, somehow by staying out of the den of iniquity, you've somehow purified yourself, you know?
I was just thinking this too. I hadn't thought of this in a while, but I do think that young men, I do think there's a part of a boy that does want to be good and noble brave and a hero. And we don't give boys credit enough for that, I don't think. I do think they are looking for ways to, you know, to be, you know, some idea of courageous.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, for sure.
And I remember feeling that way, but I don't think it was just Christian kids or just boys. I think boys now, I see it in my son, you know, there are things that really do resonate. And oftentimes they're just kind of looking for an excuse or some support to do the right thing.
Yeah. I think that when teen boys are looking to do the right thing, it's usually like, can we do this in a group? Because I need the support. I need you guys to do the right thing too, because it's going to make it a lot easier for me. For sure. And, that's why it takes a lot of courage for him to stand up and say, no, the right thing is the opposite of what you're saying right now. And for him to stand up alone and say that is what takes an amazing amount of courage. So,
Let's talk about the lip sync scene, because I did connect it to this.
Your self-indulgent scene, you mean?
I may have coupled all my film friends that the scene is too long.
But I love it. It's great, though. No, it's great.
We played with it. Like, we knew we were going to cut it at the length we shot it to be. And then we figured at some point we'd have to trim it.
Did you?
And there was a moment, me and the editor, and we were like, you know, what else in our whole lives are we just going to be able to have Final Cut on a movie? We can just do whatever we want.
It's a dangerous thing, but yeah.
We're about to break up the band. The next sequence of scenes and everything is just, we're going to break up the romance. We're going to break up the band. Let's give some moment of just pure joy.
Right.
And to me, there was a weird thing we used to do, which was stand around and lip sync to music. I mean, that seemed to be a part of that era. I just remember people would do that at talent shows.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Like, get up and lip sync.
So I was driving. I was taking my youngest is 15, and I was taking her to, she dances. So I was taking her to dance last night. I just had one of my playlists on in the car. And Should I Stay or Should I Go by The Clash. Playlist. And I looked at her and I said, okay, you've heard this enough times now that you should know it. So we're singing along. And, and she sang. And I, at the end of it, I told her, look, I was in high school at a competition and we came in second place with this song. It was a lip sync competition. And I said we should have been first, but Will Smith's song that was popular, Parents Just Don't Understand, incredibly popular that summer. And the guys who did that came in first. It was a current song where Should I Stay or Should I Go is more like a classic, but yeah. We should have won, but you know, whatever.
Well, we kept it at the length. When we showed the movie to Striper, in fact, Michael Sweet, the lead singer, goes, "You played the whole song." I was like, with admiration. He was very happy about that. I was like, "Yeah, man, yeah." That's the moment where the only moment of the movie where we just have no conflicts.
Well, and you know what? I was enjoying watching them revel in their triumph in the moment of decision. Mm-hmm. Like they've made the decision and they're just having a blast together and singing a song by their idols, you know? Mm-hmm. So it is a moment, and it's not just lip sync. They're singing it, joy. They're really singing it,
we left the audio from the room partly so people wouldn't be confused that they were singing it like a musical. Right, right. We want you to hear that. It's a lip sync thing, but another huge thing in the scene that it does in the delicate balance of switching protagonists. The movie does a thing where Eric's the protagonist up until Sarah's the protagonist.
Yeah.
At the end of the movie, we kind of said, you know, the reveal is that it was her story all along, but that's the first time that she's in the band, you know, without question, she has crossed the line and she's one of the boys, so to speak. She's become, you know, essential. And that was another way to show that.
I think part of the joy of the scene too, is everybody in the band, you know, everybody gets their moment.
Yeah.
And I think that's part of the joy of it too, that it's not just, you know, it's not just your lead singer who's lip syncing it. It's literally everybody who's part of the group gets their moment to shine, you know, and show their joy at the music, which I think is part of the joy of
that. That was the kind of scene that we would have shot, you know, when we were teenagers. If there was a sleepover at somebody's house, we would have said, let's shoot a music video for Stripers.
Yeah.
To hell with the devil, grab a video camera.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, we did that kind of stuff all the time. And that's, you know, I was telling you, this Should I Stay or Should I Go with my daughter? And it's like, I still do it in the car. You know, I sing along with whatever songs I love that are still old ones and a lot of the Beatles songs and things like that, because I love doing that, you know, because we still love music. Like do you not sing along to music in the car still?
I make the faces. I perform the song in the car.
I still air guitar in the car, you know? So I was doing it with Should I Stay or Should I Go? There's like great parts to air guitar too.
Man, so, Gen X is going to have some great nursing homes in the future.
Yeah, right. The music is going to be great. I mean,
it is. You know, and we're going to be like in our walkers, like lip syncing. I think lip sync contest should make a comeback
in nursing homes. Yeah. In 20 years. Yeah. We love music. I mean, it's funny cause during my commute, I listen to podcasts a lot more than anything else, but, I don't do it when I have my kids in the car or my wife in the car because nobody wants to listen to my podcast.
Yeah,
so, so I always turn on music when anybody else is in the car. And then what I've noticed lately is when they get out of the car, I'm into a song and I don't want to turn the song off, or I don't want to turn that playlist off because I'm really enjoying it. And so I just turn it up and I start lip sync, or not lip syncing, but singing along.
Should I go? If you say that you are mine, I'll be here till the end of time. So you got to let me know. Should I stay or should I go? It's always tease, tease, tease.
You know, when I was writing 7 short films about our marriage, I was trying to write about people who were younger and contemporary. And so I went to my daughter who was in college at the time and I said, what are you listening to now?
Ooh, you know, that's good. That's a good idea.
And she created a Spotify playlist for me, which I then played for the composer. And I said, this is the stuff I was listening to when I was writing it. And then we created, you know, well, I mean, he did the music. I don't want to act like I created any music for it, but he created the music from the stuff, or at least inspired in part by stuff we were listening to.
I love that. That's a great idea. Great idea. Yeah.
And I'm, the thing I'm writing now, I don't have specific music in my head, but it's funny because I, you know, I'm writing sequences where I'm like, and the music's going to be amazing here, you know, because I'm thinking about visual sequences where music is going to be the core, you know, to the thing. So,
I will sometimes just write a temp song, instrumental or a song into a script I'm working on just as a reference, just so I remember.
Yeah. I've done that. Oh, totally done that. Yeah.
This feels like this. I'm so glad that we got to talk.
I loved it.
I could talk to you about movies, our own or other people's movies, all day.
Me too.
And we need more time together to do that. But if you're listening to this and you're a kid and you're interested in going to school and learning about film, Baylor should definitely be on your list. They have all sorts of things.
Yes, please.
Going on at Baylor. I've seen the films that your students have made and they're stunning. They're like so amazing for undergraduate work. It's a school where you can go and study a bunch of things and not just film. It's not a conservatory, but you can go and have a great college experience and you have all those amazing sports to watch. Be a part of.
We've had national championship in both basketball, late women's and men's, and you know, Big 12 championship in men's football. So you know, if that stuff matters to you, but yeah, we have a great film program, great theater program, and. But we love our students. I mean, I think, you know, we love working with our students and we're working on at a graduate level. We're in the proposal stage of an MFA program right now.
Oh,
and so hopefully we'll have an MFA program launching in the next year or so.
Well, again, if you're looking to study film, that should be on your list. And if you're a parent of a student who's looking to study film, just check it out. And there are opportunities outside of Waco, even inside of the program. They have an incredible, really well-established New York City-based program, and you're launching.
We are launching this summer our Los Angeles program.
So it's cool. Yes. So you can go off for a semester and experience these centers of production, you know, with an internship, you know, where you're working in the industry, but also getting your coursework done. It's a pretty stunning thing. So.
And you can work on the films that we make here, like Seven Short Films That's About right. Our Marriage, and get course credit in the summer while working on the crew, not just getting coffee or, you know, drinks for somebody, but actually working with professional department heads, like professional cinematographer, professional actors. And as Chris said, those films are distributed and, you know, that's our professional work. So our students are working on those films with us.
You get those credits on IMDb that are actually real credits, you know, and which is helpful as you launch yourself into the industry. This is interesting. Barry Wirtz, correct me if I'm wrong, but you found the music for Electric Jesus first, and then you kind of came into the film. Is that right?
Yes, that is correct. The Danielson EP, the Electric Jesus EP that he released.
Okay. So you knew, so Danielson family was a part of, you have some history with Danielson then.
Yeah, I've been listening to his music for quite a while. I was actually introduced to it by my brother. But yeah, been a big fan of his work for a while.
Older brother, younger brother?
Older brother, yes.
Cooler brother?
Yes. So I was a teenager in the mid-90s.
So you were, yeah, that's around the time Danielson family kind of broke out a little bit. And were you a church kid? Were you a youth group kid?
Oh, yes, very much so. I grew up going to church. Grandfather was a pastor. My dad had pastored at times. So, yeah, wow. Definitely.
And what kind of church?
The church that I was born into, I honestly don't know, because I was a little kid. I don't know what denomination they were. But they had a split because the pastor, he actually became the president of Wheaton College. And so when he left, everybody kind of split different ways. So then we ended up going to a Southern Baptist church in Memphis, which is where I was born. And then moved again and then ended up in a Methodist church.
So your parents were pretty devout, pretty serious about it, had ideas about where you guys would go to church. When did that become like a thing for you? Are you one of these people that was just like interested in it and a Christian kid your whole life?
It was something that I was always interested in. It was such a part of life. Early in elementary school, I also went to private school. So it was just kind of a part of my overall culture.
So music was a part of that.
Yes, it was a huge part. I mean, we listened to Christian music pretty much solely. You know, we spent Saturdays at Zondervan picking up cassettes and CDs.
Some people don't realize that those of us who were into Christian rock music when we were younger, the place you would buy it was like a Christian bookstore, a store that would not just sell Bibles or Christian books, but they also had, they had kind of cheesy Christian trinkets, a lot of them.
They did. Testaments were a big one.
Yeah, the little mints, they were called testaments. If they were stale, they were old testaments.
That's right.
But that's where we would buy cassettes, CDs, records. And so what were some of those bands that you were into when you were a kid?
I mean, early on, I listened to a lot of just what was on the radio station. So Michael W. Smith, Amy Grant, Carmen, and then same brother who really most of my musical taste, he was the one who introduced me to most of it because he's 5 years older than me. So he was kind of he tested all the waters and then would say, yeah, this band's really good. So got into DC Talk. That was kind of my band for a long time. But then definitely broke into Striper, Holy Soldier, Altar Boys, Bride, Angelica.
In your friends, like your youth group friends, was everybody into that scene? Or were you like the evangelist for Christian music? Or was everybody down with DC Talk?
I had certain friends that had a very similar upbringing as me, so kind of grew up in the Christian household, listened predominantly to Christian music. As I got older and our youth group was expanding more, definitely had kids who were just listening to everything under the sun as far as, you know, Christian music, secular music. I'd say definitely more secular. Christian music wasn't really something they were familiar with.
Right, right.
So the town that I grew up in was a really small kind of country town in Michigan. You know, people weren't AC/DC, Skid Row.
Did you feel like when you were a kid, when music is so much of our identity, right? We get so much identity from what we're listening to. Mm-hmm. Would you make mixtapes for friends and say, hey, school friend that likes Skid Row, here's a tape I made you. Right.
No, I would mostly do that just with the Christian friends. And probably some of that I would have done with the secular music friends had it not been for the fact that I don't just have one older brother, I have two. And so they were kind of always like, no, that's a bad idea. Don't be that guy. So, you know, they kind of protected me and kept me, you know, from making some big faux pas.
Well, then, you know, in that scene that we're talking about, the scene where Eric kind of has his big hero moment and he jumps in and says something that I remember hearing a lot. We got to get to where the people are, right? We want to share. In effect, he's saying we want to share our faith with other people.
Right.
The pushback being, I don't know if we as Christians should be in a place that would not be God honoring. Mm-hmm. You know, the specific issue is alcohol, but there's a lot of other stuff that comes with that too. Do you remember conversations like that?
Like for me myself, if I was going to go somewhere, you know, I just thought I carry my Christianity with me everywhere. So no matter where I am, that should just be present, not necessarily that I have to preach it everywhere I go, but it's just present. But I would definitely say as a kid, and I'm sure some of it's just from not necessarily the way I was raised, but I think some of the culture, if I had heard of a band that I was a fan of, that was a Christian band, if I heard, oh, they're playing at this bar, I'd be like, what are they allowed to do that? Kind of like that seems to be crossing some line. When I watched the film and I definitely related a lot with Eric just because I could see ways in which he would do things like, yeah, I was definitely the same way in how I acted.
It almost like, if you're not a Christian, this would sound so weird, but where you feel like God wants you to do something, mm-hmm. you know, you feel led to do something. And it's more than just, you know, you run it through your brain and you check it and you're like, this isn't just some hidden desire of me. Like, I really think the Holy Spirit is speaking to me and telling me to do something. And I get that from Eric in that scene. Mm-hmm. I also remember being in cheap hotel rooms with church friends, because if we were going on some, I don't know, some trip or some retreat, of course, we're going to rent the cheapest hotel right. possible. and by the end of the stay, you know, goodness gracious, I mean, I'm sure we trashed many a hotel room
right. just
being dumb teenagers. We didn't burn anything down, but we were, oh, man. I know you work in film now. Mm-hmm. You're teaching at Lipscomb mm-hmm. University. You're a filmmaker. When did that change start happening between being a consumer of creative things to being a creator of creative things?
I started with music, playing guitar at 14.
Oh, cool.
I had friends who played instruments and family members, and we would, you know, have numerous different bands and writing, and I kind of got into wanting to record, kind of the concept of, if I'm going to create this, I want to be able to give it to people.
Yeah, right.
At 17, bought some equipment, just started doing some recording. And while I was in college, it was one of those scenarios where I didn't necessarily want to pursue music. And the main reason was people had told me, well, you don't want to go into the thing that you're passionate about, because when it's a job, you lose interest in it.
Yeah, that's tough.
Yeah, you know, now looking back, I'm like, well, you want to do the thing you love.
Yeah, yeah. What a tough message.
Yeah. Mm. But I'd always loved film and watching film. My family, we always had movies playing. Blockbuster was Friday night every week. And mm-hmm. the school that I attended for my undergrad, they didn't have anything in film or production, but there was just a handful of us who were really interested in it. So we started kind of compiling ideas and getting professors to teach classes, and kind of sought some outside sources and just started creating a program for them. At that time, it was one of those, I really enjoy doing this and I know I can teach as well. So I was actually pursuing my degree to teach others how to create.
Barry, man, that's ambitious stuff. And that's, I really admire that. Was your undergrad like a Christian school? Or?
Yeah, it was a Christian university. From there, I went on and did my first master's at a school in New York. And so now I'm at Lipscomb, and then I also teach at another college here in Tennessee. And then I'm also attending Lipscomb in their MFA program.
I'm a big fan of Lipscomb because when we were at the Nashville Film Festival with Electric Jesus, there was a screening at Lipscomb. They showed us so much hospitality. Brian Baumgartner came, played basketball. It was like a dreamy thing. The whole cast, unbelievable. Yeah. Lipscomb.
Both schools that I'm at are doing great things, but you know, with Lipscomb, what drew me to them is just really what their program focuses on. They have a great film program, which is headed up by Steve Taylor, who I know you're friends with and you've spoken mm-hmm. with on the podcast before. And then we have an animation department, which we have the Bancroft brothers from Disney and Mike Naraki of VeggieTales. So just amazing professors, and they're just all incredible people. What I love about all of them is they are well-known, famous people, but they're the most approachable people. Like, they don't act like they're anybody. They're just as humble as can be. The education level is extremely high there. The resources, the connections, everything there is just, they've put a lot of effort into making a program that when you graduate, you are actually ready to go into the industry.
Yeah.
Miren al pepino.
Watch the cucumber. See how he moves. Like a lion chasing a mouse.
Miren al pepino.
Watch the cucumber.
Es suave, es movimiento.
Oh, how smooth his motion.
Es como
like butter
en un chango
on a
pelón.
Bald monkey.
Miren al pepino.
Watch the cucumber.
Los vegetales.
All the vegetables
envidia a su amigo.
Envy their friend. Wishing
bailar.
To dance as he.
Pepino bailarín.
Dancing cucumber.
Pepino bailarín.
Dancing cucumber.
Pepino bailarin.
Dancing cucumber.
Baila, baila,
dance, dance, yeah.
When I think about Christian music, mm-hmm. music that was specifically Christian, that kind of music doesn't really exist anymore.
It doesn't, no.
Eventually, artists that were Christians just had bands and made music.
Right.
And then the ones that wanted to sing worship music, mm-hmm. like church, kind of like the rock and roll that you would hear at a mega church or something.
Right.
That does exist. There mm-hmm. is a thing with that. But the kind of music that I remember where it was just specifically, you buy it at the Christian bookstore, the lyrics are about Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't exist anymore.
It doesn't.
But what does still exist in film, at least, is there is a kind of film that is like the old Christian music. It's like a film
yes.
that's made for Christians, and it's meant to, I guess, support and teach and maybe even in some cases reflect back to Christians things mm-hmm. that they believe. Where do you stand on that? Are you would you consider yourself a Christian filmmaker or just a filmmaker who happens to be Christian? Where are you on that continuum?
So I would say I don't put myself in either camp. I mean, I definitely would say I'd probably lean more towards I'm a filmmaker who is a Christian, but as a Christian, I still can't really escape Christian themes.
Right.
You know, when I write a script, a lot of times I'm reflecting myself or some of my childhood. So that's always mm-hmm. there. And I have kids too. And so when I create something, I don't want to necessarily create something that I'm going to make and then say, but you're not allowed to watch it because it's not for you. You know, that is a part of it too for me.
I found it to be a real weird struggle when I was first with Electric Jesus because I'm a Christian making a movie about Christians with just no, I didn't have the agenda, you know,
mm-hmm.
like I was exploring ideas that didn't have to do with persuading someone to become a Christian,
right.
which would be one, or, you know, some aspect of culture war Christianity or something.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of those films like will zero in on some topic, right?
Right.
And I didn't really have a topic. And then as I wrote, the characters started saying things, and some of the things they said were just bonehead, dumb kid things
yeah.
that I let them say.
Right.
That in some cases sounded like, I don't know, just kind of an immature Christianity. The movie became confusing to some people because they were like, wait a minute, is he for this? Is he against this? And all I was doing really was just trying to remember my friends and tell their stories. And I know some people had, and I'm sure you've met people like this, Barry, who had really bad experiences with
yes.
church and youth group, and there's trauma connected. Mm-hmm. Well, it wasn't that way for me.
Neither.
You know, I did learn some stuff that wasn't positive and wasn't good. And
exactly.
But I'm not hampered by it like some people are.
Right.
So my story is going to come out and generally be kind of cheerful about it all.
Yeah. And that's what I appreciated about it is I do often see kind of two sides of the spectrum when you have people who are making a film that is a analysis of Christianity. You have the one camp who is the like, I was burned by Christianity, so I just want to really mock it and point out mm-hmm. all of the ridiculousness so that everyone else is in my camp and sees how ridiculous it is. And then you have like the other people, like you said, who might make the well, I really want it to be super Christian and, you know, everyone has to get saved at the end and have this come to Jesus moment. And I thought with your film, it was just, you did a good job of just balancing, like, this was the reality of it. Like, I'm not upset at it. You know, there were things that are very cringy that we've done, we still do, but there was a lot of good things that came out of it. And, you know, a lot of us did have a very good experience with it.
Well, I appreciate you saying that. I think that the trick to that, if I was talking to a writer, I would say the trick to that is loving the characters.
Mm-hmm.
And if you love your characters, then you extend grace to them. Here now I'm talking like a Christian again.
Yeah.
like you said, it just seeps into the,
it's there.
You know what I mean? Like,
exactly.
it's, we gotta cut them some slack,
mm-hmm.
you know, and we live in such a graceless time. Nobody cuts anybody any slack anymore.
Right.
And, so yeah, there's a section where me and my wife just sit cringing the whole way through and, but we're also kind of nodding like, yeah, I mean, yeah, mm-hmm. that's the way it was. I hope people don't think we're saying this is the way you should act.
Right.
The Christian audience, I feel like far too, they need us to give them things that have layers of meaning
mm-hmm.
and
yes.
and have levels to them that are not on the nose or
right.
easy.
Right.
And, you know, like I really enjoyed Jesus Revolution, the recent Irwin Brothers movie about the roots of Christian music in Southern California. There's a lot, especially the first half. I was really on board for the ride. I didn't feel like it was pushing an agenda. Mm-hmm. I didn't feel like it was trying to make me feel or think something. I think it was just, it was a beautiful rendering. I think it gets away from them at the end a little bit, but that's something you and I can discuss over coffee and not in a public forum like
exactly. Yeah, we're not here to bash anybody. So
no, not at all, not at all. Go see Jesus Revolution.
That's right.
As you're thinking back to young you and knowing what you do now, you're working with students, you have your own kids, and you're thinking about that kind of, for lack of a better word, just charming Christian world you grew up in that had some foibles, but was also safe. It was a nest to be in, I guess, when you were young. What would you want to say, like, if you could go back and talk to the young you?
Definitely for me, it would just be, you know, this is the time to take the risks that you're afraid of. You know, I think for a lot of us, when we were in youth group, you know, there was just a lot of information coming in. We had one set of, if you're in public school, coming at us, then you had the church coming at us, and there was just a lot of confusion. And so we all did our best to be, quote unquote, the best Christian we could be. So I think for me, there was times where it wouldn't have even been wrong to do, but just because of the mindset I had, I was just afraid to mess up or do anything that would seem wrong or sinful. You know, it's okay to take some risks. And if you mess up, that is what grace is, you know. Don't be so afraid of messing up.
That's really good advice. And probably young you would have said, well, I'm still going to be very careful.
Right. I would have. I know myself. I would have been like, yeah, you might be right, but no, you're wrong. So
who's this old guy?
Right.
Yeah. And I think there's a lot of that in Electric Jesus. Mm-hmm. You know, the idea of just hanging out with your friends and having fun makes Jesus happy too.
Right.
And there was so much purpose in what we were supposed to, in the work of being in the youth group. The whole Make Jesus Famous aspect of it.
Right.
It was really driving and a little stressful sometimes, honestly. Or for introverted people that weren't real outgoing, it's like even more, like, I gotta tell people about this. I don't even like
exactly. If I give you one takeaway from the movie, I mean, it's maybe not necessarily pertaining to the scene we're discussing, but just the overall theme, like you're talking about, with just kind of the making Jesus famous, which of course is my favorite line in the film, where Sarah, you know, tells Eric, you know, Jesus doesn't need you to make him famous. He's already famous. For me, that was just like a, wow, like he just wants us to come along for the ride. Like he's going to do what he's going to do. And he wants you to come along for the ride. Like it's not your, it just takes a weight off your shoulders. Like it's not your job. He's just, he's going to do it and you're welcome to join him. He will use you, but just come along and enjoy the ride. So, you know, for me, that was just when she said that, I was like, huh, that's great.
Boy, I love how it plays in the scene, and I love how it just takes the wind out of his sails, and it just, it reminds me of that. There's a line in a U2 song that Bono wrote that talks about helping God across the street like a little old lady. It's like, we're busy helping God across the street like a little old lady.
Right.
It's like, no, that is not. We don't need to help God across the street.
Exactly. Exactly. Stop helping God across the road like a little old lady.
Electric Jesus is available wherever you stream movies. Check the links in the show notes to find the award-winning film, the soundtrack, a merch table filled with cool EJ stuff, and links to our guests and their work. If you enjoy the podcast, please be sure to rate and subscribe to it on your preferred player, and check out all the amazing extras we curate on the Electric Jesus YouTube page. Thanks for listening. Ego's not really the enemy. It's like a small child crossing an 8-lane highway on the voyage of discovery. Stand up to rock stars. Napoleon is in high heels. Josephine, be careful. Our small man with big ideas.
Yeah, Satan's Clutch. That's the band that they bit the head off of a ferret.
Gross.